Hi guys, welcome to the Universe View Odyssey channel. Now, let's start the quantum odyssey. What is quantum? As I begin the quantum theory odyssey, I would like to know the meaning of quantum theory in the era. Let me ask you a question first. What if the computer disappeared right now? Q1, I can't imagine. There would be no civilization. Without quantum theory, arguably, computers would never have existed. Doesn't this alone deserve an answer to the meaning of quantum theory in the era? Quantum theory is not only a very successful theory, but it is applied so widely that it is no exaggeration to say that it is the cornerstone that supports modern civilization. If quantum theory hadn't been born in the early 20th century, the way people live today would be completely different. So I think it's right to call modern civilization a quantum civilization. Therefore, it is necessary to know quantum theory in order to understand the view of the universe implied by modern civilization. Q2, but people say it's too difficult to understand. Why? In fact, even experts and physicists say it's difficult. Richard Feynman, Nobel laureate in physics, 1965, reputed to be the greatest physicist since Einstein, once said, "There are many people who can use quantum theory, but no one really understands it." Also, Niels Bohr, the godfather of quantum theory, said, "Anyone who is not shocked by quantum theory is someone who does not know quantum theory." The words of these two physicists are eventually interpreted to mean that quantum theory is as difficult to understand. Even Einstein, who played a decisive role in the birth of quantum theory with his light quantum hypothesis, raised questions about quantum theory and refused to accept quantum theory for the rest of his life. Q3, it's comforting to hear that geniuses say it's difficult, but why on earth do geniuses say it's difficult? The reason they say it is difficult is by no means because quantum mechanics is theoretically incomplete or mathematical formulas are difficult. Quantum mechanics is mathematically very clearly described, and the theory deserves to be asserted to be perfect. It is experimentally proven without any error, and the technical engineering application is also amazing. Even so, the reason they can't understand quantum theory is because quantum theory is in direct conflict with our common sense. In other words, quantum theory is beyond our common sense and intuition. Quantum theory demands a change to our familiar view of the universe, the mechanistic view of the universe. Furthermore, quantum theory presents a new view of nature and the universe. It's not easy to accept that right away. Q4, what are some examples? A typical example is that problems arise from the concept of objective reality, which is the subject of science. Objective reality was considered to have unique properties independent of the thoughts or observations of the human experimenter. But, in the quantum world, you don't know the exact properties of the object until you measure, you can only check the measurement results. Moreover, repeating the same experiment sometimes yields different results. Also, in the quantum world, an object can exist in two places at the same time. Q5, now let's get into the quantum theory odyssey. As the first step, shouldn't we know quantum? What the heck is quantum? If I tell you the representative quantum is an electron, proton and a photon, it would be easier to picture the quantum for you. Quantum originally meant the smallest unit energy particle. Quantum's quan comes from the Latin word for quantitas. It has the same etymology as English quantity. Quantum has become a common noun, and it refers to subatoms, particles that make up an atom, such as photons, electrons, neutrons, and protons mentioned above. Q6. They are objects of the microscopic world. Who coined this word, when and how? In 1900, the last year of the 19th century, German physicist Max Planck first introduced it through the quantum hypothesis. The quantum hypothesis, simply put, is the hypothesis that heat emitted from a black body like a furnace, that is, the energy of electromagnetic waves, is composed of extremely small energy grains. The idea that electromagnetic waves, such as sunlight are energy grains, particles, was an outrageous and absurd idea at the time. This absurd idea changed the stem of physics and changed the world. Planck received the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1918 for this feat, and became a respected figure in German physics. Q7, light waves are composed of energy grains. I can't believe it even now when I think about it. So, what does it mean to pay attention to energy grains, or quanta, compared to previous physics? This is a key question. The physical significance of quantum discovery is that the amount of energy exists in multiples of a quantum, that is, energy exists discretely. Shall I give an example? The sack is full of 1-1, 10-1, 100-1, and 500-1 coins. Let's say it's total 500 million won. Start with the largest unit of 500 won. After taking out 4,999,999 won, there was only 1-1 coin left in the sack. In the sack, there is 1-1 left before the money goes to zero. There is no such thing as 50 jun or 20 jun in coins, so the minimum amount that can be put in a bag is 1-1, which is the smallest unit of coin. Here you can exchange money for energy and coins for quanta. Quanta have large and small energy chunks. However, just as the smallest unit of money is the 1-1 coin, both have the smallest unit. It means that there is no energy between zero and the smallest unit quantum. In this earlier physics, the amount of energy was considered to be a smoothly continuous value rather than a lump. Looking further into the quantum hypothesis, it is suggested that the existence of the smallest energy grain, quantum, means an indivisible limit, and therefore there must be a limit to the causal description of this world. Here comes a notice that the causal and mechanistic view of the universe and the world, which have been formed by intuition and experience, will face challenges. Q8. There is a saying that quantum mechanics was born in a furnace. What does this mean? In order to understand the concept of quantum, it is necessary to know the background of the era when this term was born. Two industrial backgrounds emerge. Let's go to Germany in the middle of the 19th century. At that time, Germany had a thriving steel industry. Iron products are sensitively influenced by the temperature inside the furnace, but there was no way to measure the temperature. So the artisans estimated the temperature by looking at the light. It was necessary to establish an accurate relationship between color and temperature. Q9, what's the other one? Electrical industry. At that time, as the electromagnetic theory was completed, street lights were installed in German cities. However, a debate arose about which is better, the classic gas lamp or the newly developed electric lamp. This soon came down to the question of which light source is more energy efficient. street lights are like the furnace problem because they are, after all, light energy emitted by heated filaments. Therefore, these two issues are ultimately a matter of knowing the relationship between light energy emitted by an object, temperature, color. Germany established the Imperial Institute for Physical Engineering in Berlin in 1887 to theoretically address this problem. Q10. I'm impatient with what this has to do with quantum. You came to the conclusion that you need to know the relationship between temperature and color in order to compare the superiority of light energy emitted by objects, and even established a research institute. Is this a national task? You're right. While working on this problem, a crisis occurred in theoretical physics. Q11, a physics crisis. A problem called blackbody radiation that is well known in history of physics. It may be an unfamiliar term to the general public, but if you simply think of a furnace as a blackbody and have only one small hole drilled in it, you can think of the light coming out of it as blackbody radiation. Q12, a light's finally starting to come out of the furnace. You're right. The light from the furnace is a quantum, but this was known a little later. The blackbody radiation theory came out because it is necessary to know the energy-temperature-color relationship for ideal light, in order to compare the relationship between light and temperature in a furnace or the superiority of light sources between gas and electric lamps. The ideal light that serves as the standard is blackbody radiation. Q13. But why is this causing a physics crisis? British physicists John William Rayleigh and James Jeans proposed a theoretical solution to the problem of blackbody radiation. But this does not match the experimental curve. The Rayleigh-Jeans theory was based on existing physics, classical physics, such as Maxwell's electromagnetic theory and Boltzmann's energy equipartition law, which were considered perfect at the time. So it was no different from a crisis in the physics world. Q14. Can you easily explain the meaning that the energy wavelength graph derived from theory and the graph derived from experiment do not match? That's a good question. For example, what is the sum of light energy, blackbody radiation energy from a furnace? Common sense tells us that it is not infinite without calculation. Because you can't put materials that will generate infinite energy in a furnace. However, according to the graph of Rayleigh-Jeans theory, infinite energy comes out. This makes no sense. Q15. Is it because classical physics is wrong after all? You're right. According to the classical theory, Boltzmann's energy equipartition law, the light from the furnace is an electromagnetic wave, and each electromagnetic wave has the same energy. However, the number of electromagnetic waves is infinite. So the total energy must be infinite. Q16. Then, if the light coming out of the furnace is not an electromagnetic wave, but a particle, a grain, i.e. a quantum, it will be solved. However, if the number of grains of certain energy is infinite, like electromagnetic waves, wouldn't the sum of them be infinite? You hit the key question. It's not easy to explain, but I'll try. What is the core idea of Planck's theory that solved the blackbody radiation problem? He assumed that the energy of electromagnetic waves emitted from a blackbody is emitted in the form of extremely small particles, so-called energy quanta. and the magnitude of the energy is proportional to the frequency. This is the famous quantum hypothesis. In this way, the term quantum, which means the smallest lump, came to the fore in the history of physics. According to this quantum hypothesis, energy can only have values that are integer multiples of this minimum chunk, and values such as 0.3 times and 1.7 times the basic chunk cannot exist. For example, suppose the energy allocation of an electromagnetic wave emitted from a furnace, blackbody, at a specific temperature is 400 W. Of course, the higher the temperature, the higher the allocation. According to Boltzmann's energy equipartition law, the amount of energy emitted is infinite because infinite electromagnetic waves come out in 400 W. On the other hand, according to Planck's concept of energy grains, an electromagnetic wave with energy quanta of 1 W can be carried by hanging 400 quanta. An electromagnetic wave with energy quanta of 100 W will complete its task by carrying 4 quantum packets. However, for an electromagnetic wave with a very high frequency, where one energy quantum is equivalent to 500 W, even one quantum exceeds the quota, 400 W. According to Planck's hypothesis, such electromagnetic waves cannot exist at all. This is because electromagnetic waves are assumed to carry energy only in the smallest unit energy quantum proportional to their frequency. In this way, the number of electromagnetic waves that can contribute to the energy inside the ceramic, black body, is finitely reduced, and therefore the total amount of energy emitted is also finite. The higher the frequency of the electromagnetic wave, the larger the smallest unit of energy, quantum, it has, so the number of electromagnetic waves contributing to carrying the energy quota is limited, and therefore the total amount of energy emitted is always finite. Based on this bold hypothesis, Planck succeeded in realizing the absurd value of infinite energy emitted from a black body into a finite value. Q17, I think this would have been recorded as a monumental event in physics. Planck presented the theory of blackbody radiation at the historic meeting of the Berlin Physics Society on December 14th of that year. The scientific world records this day as the birth date of quantum physics. But the funny thing is that Planck himself didn't believe that electromagnetic waves were actually energy grains for a while. It's such a groundbreaking idea that even he himself can't believe it. After this, people came to think that the world is not what it used to be. This is because energy, and by extension nature, is not continuous. Even flowing rivers and ropes that appear to be continuous are broken into water atom grains when viewed microscopically. Even energy and time do. Even the law of causation, cause-effect relationship, becomes unreliable if there is not a seamless connection between cause and effect. Planck himself solved the problem of classical mechanics mathematically, but he did not believe that light energy was grainy, and he did not believe in the discontinuity implied by his hypothesis. In next video, I will introduce Einstein's light quantum hypothesis. Thanks for watching.